John Edwards has called on each of us to take an action to build the America we believe in, and I am proud that he is joining us today to share his vision, and I am proud of the courageous leadership of his wife, Elizabeth. And their decision to continue this campaign. As a cancer survivor, there is no other challenge but to continue to live your dreams and your values. It keeps us alive. Please welcome my friend, John Edwards.
Thank you. Thank you.
By the way, the first thing you should know is when politicians do this, they don't mean it. That's what they mean. Thank you. Well, thank you to Art for his extraordinary leadership, and I want to join Senator Obama and others who have recognized the loss of Juanita Milliner McDonald, who was an extraordinary woman and a great leader for the state of California and for America. I also want to say to all of you a personal thank you. I spoke to my wife, Elizabeth, this morning, and she said to send you her love and thank you for your support and for her and for our family. Elizabeth's doing absolutely great. I want to start by just saying a word about what's at stake in this election and say a word about our party, because I have such a strong belief of what the Democratic Party is supposed to represent. You know, we are past the time for cautious, poll-driven politics. It is time for us to lead again. It is time for us to lead bravely, boldly, to take America where it needs to go. It's time for the rest of the world to see our better angels. It is time for the rest of the world to see an America that is compassionate and understands its responsibility to humanity. I want to say first a word about the bleeding sore that is Iraq. You know, a lot of you know this. I want to be very direct with you about it. I voted for this war, and I was wrong to vote for this war. I should never have voted for this war. And I want you to know I am speaking out with every fiber of my being to get America out of Iraq. We need to be leaving Iraq. And we ought to start today, not 2 months from now, not 3 months from now. We ought to start pulling our troops out of Iraq today. And I want to say a word. I want to say just a word about what's happening right now, because we are in a historic moment. The Congress, the democratically led Congress, and by the way, elections have consequences, don't they? Our victory in 2006 means something. And our leaders in the Congress have submitted a bill to the President under their funding authority that establishes a timetable for withdrawal from Iraq. The President of the United States has said he intends to veto that bill. Here's the truth. Here's the truth. If the President of the United States vetoes that bill, it's George Bush who's not supporting the troops, not the Congress. And we need the Congress to stand firm and strong. If the President vetoes this bill, they should send him back another bill with a timetable for withdrawal. And if he vetoes that, they should send him another one back with a timetable for withdrawal. They should not back down from this president and let him continue on this terrible course in Iraq. We have to show strength and courage. This is about life and death. This is about war. And we have to be strong. But as we're leaving Iraq, it's also critical that we recognize that we have to change what's happening in the world, not just Iraq, although Iraq's enormously important. The world needs to see America as a force for good again. Right now, they think we're a bully. They think we're selfish. They don't look up to and respect the United States of America. They're not interested in following America. That has to change. Here's what I think needs to happen. The next president of the United States needs to travel the world and speak to the world, as great American presidents have in the past. And the message needs to be, and I'm not the first to say it, the message needs to be, America's not just a place, America's an idea. And that idea is equality and diversity. It is who we are as a nation. The world needs to hear that from America because they don't believe it. The world believes we're at war with the Muslim world. That has to change. And the second thing that has to happen is the world needs to see our commitment to humanity. There are so many ways for us to demonstrate that. Let me mention a couple today. Right now, at this moment, there's a genocide going on in Western Sudan in Darfur. Hundreds of thousands have been slaughtered at the hands of the, I've got my bracelet on, hundreds of thousands have been slaughtered at the hands of the Janjaweed militia, supported by the Sudanese government. Sudanese government's engaged in genocide. Now, instead of seeing this through our eyes, see it through the eyes of the rest of the world. This is what they say. The most powerful nation on the planet has declared that a genocide is occurring years ago, and then stepped back and watched it continue. What would you think of us? How can we be surprised? Today, there will be thousands of children born in Africa with AIDS because their mother can't pay $4 for a dose of medicine. We spend $4 on coffee in the United States. And the richest nation on the planet stands by and watches an entire new generation of children born with AIDS. What would you think of us? We're better than this. United States of America is better than this. We are not the country of Guantanamo and Abu Ghraib. The world needs to see our humanity. And here's an idea. Here's an idea, and I'll be the first to tell you, I have no idea how popular this is politically, but I'm going to stand for it because I believe it's the kind of thing America should be doing. Suppose, instead of spending $500 billion and counting in Iraq, America actually led an international effort to make primary school education available to every one of the 100 million children in the world who have no education at all, in Africa, in the Muslim world, in Latin America. This could be literally transformational in the way the world views us. The world must see America as a force for good again. And I want to say one thing very directly. When I am President of the United States, on the first day in office, you have my word that Guantanamo will be closed. Yeah. But it's not just a matter of America demonstrating its commitment to the rest of the world. We have to be an example for good at home. Here, for 4% of the world's population, we emit 25% of the world's greenhouse gases. We're not an example for good. We're an example for bad. How in the world can we go to China and India and the developing world and ask them to join us in a global solution to a problem that is a crisis? This is not an issue for the future. And for goodness sakes, people in California and the leaders in California have understood this for a long time. We need America to understand it. And we need a president of the United States that will lead America to addressing this crisis, to make certain that America understands that if we have a 4 to 8 degree temperature rise on the face of America, on the planet, over the course of the next 75 years, we're going to see migration of millions of people. Not enough food, not enough water. It's going to make world war look mild. America must understand that. Here's what I think we need to do. I think we ought to cap carbon dioxide emissions in the United States of America. We ought to ratchet that cap down every single year. Below that cap, we ought to auction off the right to emit any greenhouse gases. That'll generate $30 to $40 billion. That money should be used to completely transform the way we use energy in America. Investment in clean, alternative sources of energy, wind, solar, biofuels, biodiesel. We ought to put at least $1 billion in the development of carbon sequestration technology. We ought to put $1 billion into making sure that not somewhere else, but in the United States of America, we build the most fuel-efficient vehicles on the planet. With union workers. And last but not least, it is time for the President of the United States to ask Americans to be patriotic about something other than war. It is time for the President to ask Americans to take the action necessary to conserve, to strengthen this country, to conserve in our homes, conserve in our workplaces, to drive more fuel-efficient vehicles. We can't solve this problem just with the President and the government. All of America is going to have to be involved and be engaged. I also want to say a word about what I believe is a huge moral issue. And the reporters always say to me, by the way, why do you continue to talk about this? No one else talks about it. Why do you keep talking about 37 million people who wake up in poverty every day? I'll tell you why. Because it's wrong in the United States of America to have 37 million people who have to wake up every day worried about feeding and clothing their children. We're better than that. And I have to tell you, if my party can't be the voice for the poor, for the elderly, for the disabled, for the disenfranchised, well, what reason do we exist? We have got to stand up for those who have no voice to speak for themselves. And for all those people who say there's nothing that can be done about it, first of all, it says something about the character of America. What we do about millions of our own people who are literally worried about survival. And you think the rest of the world doesn't know? Do you believe we're the only ones that saw those pictures coming out of the Ninth Ward of New Orleans after the hurricane hit? I'm here to tell you, the whole world saw them. I saw a headline overseas after the hurricane hit. It had pictures from the lower Ninth Ward. And the headline in bold print was, "The Shaming of America." We're better than this. For all those people who tell us there's nothing that can be done, there's a lot that can be done, starting with having a living wage in America so that people who are working can actually support their families. And you want to know what the greatest anti-poverty movement in American history is, the movement that actually built the great middle class that all of us are so proud of? Organized labor built the middle class. Organized labor stood up against poverty. Organized labor created good wages with good benefits. And I have to tell you, just on a personal note, I'm so proud that over the last few years, since the last election, I've been all over America organizing, help organizing workers into unions. I'm proud of having done it. I'm proud to have walked picket lines. I'm proud to have called employers. But we need to create a level playing field in this effort. If we want to grow and strengthen the middle class in America, organized labor and organizing is a critical component. So I have a very simple idea. If you can join the Republican Party by signing your name to a card, any worker in America should be able to join a union by doing exactly the same thing. That's democracy in the workplace. That's what we believe in. And while we're at it, we ought to ban the hiring of permanent replacements for strikers and make that the law of the land. Another idea for getting kids out of poverty. We've had billions of dollars taken out of the federal budget for kids to be able to go to college, financial aid. This is insanity, complete insanity. We want to make it easier for kids to go to college. Here's an idea. I call it College for Everyone. And we've actually put it in place in a poor part of eastern North Carolina. I raised the money for it privately. But the idea is this. We said to every kid in the area, and we ought to be doing this for all of the country. We said to every kid, graduate from high school, qualify to go to college, and commit that you'll work when you're there. At least 10 hours a week, we pay for your tuition and books. Very simple. We get rid of the debt that all of our young people have. We don't just give it to them. They have to work for it. But we will never end poverty in America, which I am completely convinced we can do. We will never end poverty in America until and when we do something about a completely dysfunctional healthcare system. And I want to say to all of you, we have some wonderful candidates running for President of the United States on the Democratic side. They're good people. I respect them. But it is not enough to say you're for universal health care without laying out the specifics of how you intend to do it. We have a health care system. We have a health care system, 46, 47 million people without health care, premiums up 90% over the last 6 years. Here's what I think we ought to do. I think we ought to require every employer to cover their employees or pay into a fund. We ought to create choices so that Americans can choose in health care markets either a private choice or a government choice. And this may very well end up at single payer if the American people choose that that's where the healthcare system should go. We ought to subsidize health insurance premiums up to just under $100,000 of income. We ought to fill in all the cracks in our healthcare system, starting by banning the idea of pre-existing conditions, outlawing it, no longer a part of our healthcare system in America. We ought to cover preventative care, long-term care, chronic care, and we ought to make sure that people can take their health care with them no matter where they go. So no more of this job lock. My plan costs every single American required by law to be covered. My plan costs $90 to $120 billion a year, and I pay for it by getting rid of George Bush's tax cuts for people who make over $200,000 a year. So it's not that we don't know what needs to be done. We know what needs to be done. Getting out of Iraq, doing good things for humanity around the world, standing up for universal health care, for America leading the way on climate change, global warming, changing the way we use energy, lifting millions of families out of poverty, strengthening the middle class, and doing something about the extraordinary income inequality that still exists in America. I'm telling you, last year, the top 300,000 wage earners in America earn more than the bottom 150 million. This is not healthy. It is not good for democracy. And I've talked about some of the things we can do about it: health care, living wage, access to college, organizing. But the one thing we have to be willing to face up to, and I mean head on, is that race plays an enormous issue in America today, plays an enormous role in what's happening. I mean, the idea that race is no longer a factor After decades of slavery, followed by decades of segregation, followed by decades of discrimination, if you are a man or woman of color in America today, you are more likely to live in poverty. You are more likely to not have health care coverage. You are more likely to get cancer. You are more likely to have heart disease. You are more likely to have diabetes. We have to face up to this and do something about it. First of all, we have to be honest about the problem. The racial and economic segregation that still exists in America is not all right. Those pictures coming out of the Ninth Ward of New Orleans, they're not all right. We have to do something. We can either put our head against a wall or actually try to do something about it. Suppose, here's an idea. Suppose we create 1 million new housing vouchers in America, and instead of concentrating poor people together, we allow families to use them to move across some of these economic and racial barriers so they can live in better neighborhoods, have a place to live where they choose to live. But all these things that we want to do, all these things that we want to do will not happen unless and until we have a Democrat in the White House in 2009. And I just say to all my brothers and sisters here in California that we need a candidate for president who can campaign and compete hard in California and New York, but who can also campaign and compete hard in Iowa, in Missouri, in Georgia, in Kentucky, in Virginia, everywhere in America. We have such an extraordinary opportunity, and it's not just the presidency. We're so proud of Nancy Pelosi as Speaker of the United States House of Representatives. But all the good that we want to do requires that she remain the Speaker. It requires that we be able to win these tough House seats all across America. It requires that we be able to hold and win United States Senate seats. That's the way we bring about the bold, transformational change that America needs. That's the way we change the way the rest of the world looks at America. We have so much opportunity, and I want to say to all of you, I spoke to you earlier about Elizabeth and how she sends her love to you, and thanks all of you for your extraordinary support. But a few weeks ago, we went through this very personal experience for the two of us, and we came out of it making the decision about what we want to spend our lives doing. We want to serve this country. We love this country. Elizabeth and I both want to serve this country. But I want to say to all of you, don't remember anything else I said today. There's one last thing I want to say to you. The fact that you're here and that you're this involved and this engaged demonstrates your commitment to the country. But I think every one of us have to ask ourselves, what are you willing to do? How much are you willing to do? How much do you love America? Because there is so, you look at the big changes that have happened in this country, the civil rights movement that began on college campuses in America, speaking out against the war in Vietnam, bringing down this apartheid regime in South Africa, this effort to end this war in Iraq, the great movements that have happened in America, they didn't start in Washington, D.C. And they didn't start in the Oval Office. They started right here with people of conviction and courage and passion who would stand up for what you believe in and what you knew was right. We need you again. We need all of you to speak out, to speak up, and to build the kind of America, moral and just, that all of us believe in. God bless you, California. It's a great honor and privilege for me to be with you today. Keep fighting and keep working, and we're going to build the kind of country we believe in. Thank you all very much.
Good luck, we're with you.
Yeah, good luck.
The best so far.